Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. Jesus wanted to set forth the doctrine of his future church, but the Jews were only interested in their self-serving policies. Murder was common, and Jesus emphatically stated that murder was unacceptable regardless of the circumstances. It struck a raw nerve when the God-man talked about anger. The Son of God warned that aside from righteous anger directed at sin, this powerful emotion is not tolerated in the kingdom of God. Unforgiveness does not exist in heaven, and those who claim to be followers of Jesus need to seek reconciliation before they come to present an offering to the Lord. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. This is Resurrection Sunday, and I'm going to be talking about the doctrine that Jesus set forth in, we have it written down in the Bible. So if you want to get ready, we're going to start in Matthew chapter 5 is where we're going to start. And let's do this. Let's pray. So my Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you and praise you right now that once again, I can stand on Resurrection Sunday and preach. What a privilege. And I thank you now, Lord, for opening the word for us. Let us understand it. Let us practice it. And let us live it. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Now, when Jesus started out, he started here in chapter 5. Remember now, he had four apostles, and they had seen that Jesus had been healing, had the track record of that. And Jesus stopped in front of a mountain, and he went up a little bit to the mountain so he could be a little bit higher up. And he started teaching his doctrine, and we started in Matthew chapter 5, and today we're going to start in verse number 21. So picture this now, Jesus on the mountainside, probably 3,000 or 4,000 people below him, and this is what he said. You have heard that it was said by them of old time, you shall not kill or murder, and whosoever shall kill or murder shall be in danger of the judgment. In other words, Jesus simply said this, murder is not acceptable. I heard a commentator on television this week in a news program, and he simply said this, they were complaining about transgenders being murdered. And this commentator, he was not a bad guy, but this is how to think. He simply said this, if we take it in context, he said, last year, 44 transgenders, that were men that became women or women that became men, were murdered. But he said, if you look upon it, there were tens of thousands of murder of other people. It's not an epidemic, he said. 44 transgenders murdered, that's not a big deal. He said, let's put it in context. And then he said, people will murder. You can't stop them. And if you don't believe it, you can go to Chicago, or you can go to San Francisco, Los Angeles, or Portland, and people simply do a lot of murdering. Is it acceptable? No. Is it a sin? Yes. Jesus said, we shall not murder. If you keep your finger there and turn to Exodus chapter 20, that is the book of Exodus, chapter 20, and we pick it up here in verse Exodus 20. And we're going to pick it up in verse number 13. This is Jesus, now he spoke a few thousand years earlier, where he simply said this, in verse 13, you shall not kill. The word here is murder. You shall not murder. You shall not take the life of somebody else. That's part of the Ten Commandments. So why do people murder? Number one, they're demon-possessed. Number two, they're angry. They simply don't care. They get to a place where they just don't care. And this is one of the things Jesus said, you shall not murder. Now, abortion is murder. Let me ask you a stupid question here. When did you begin to exist? Did you begin to exist the moment that your mom and dad's egg and sperm joined and you were conceived? Did you begin to exist at a time when your heart would start beating? Or did you begin to exist when you were born, you came out from your mother's womb? Or did you start to exist when you started your school? When does life begin? And the answer is, it begins at conception. What happened at conception? You have an egg, you got a sperm, they come together, and now we got a beginning of a body. But that cell, not as formed, is now united with a soul. And the soul is a real person. When you die, when your body dies, the brain goes in the grave, your body goes in the grave, where they incinerate you, whatever they do with you, depending upon how much money they would spend on your funeral. But your body dies, but your soul and your spirit, if you're born again, goes to heaven. If you're not born again, your soul and dead spirit goes to hell. I am not the body. I am inside the body. I have a soul. So here's what happened. When you have an abortion, you kill the physical body and you stop the soul from being born on the earth. Now, in John chapter 3, Jesus said this, a man has to be born of water and of the Spirit. You've got to be born twice. If John 3, chapter 3 is true, matter of fact, I'm going to flip to that because I can see some eyeballs rolling here. So let's turn to the Gospel of John, and we're going to go to chapter 3. Okay. John chapter 3. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are from a teacher come from God. For no man can do these miracles that you do except God be with him. Jesus answered and said to him, Verily, verily, I said to you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, How can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I said to you, except a man be born of water at physical birth and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. This is what Jesus said. Now, if we take this word as what it says, it means that if you do not have a chance to be born physically, you cannot be born spiritually. Which logically says that all children aborted went to hell. Now that's going to start a screaming in the church and say, you can't say that. Because, you know, little children belongs to God and God understands and God would take the babies and so on. But Jesus didn't say that. You had to be born physically. You had to be born again, second time. If God had got a different program, I don't know. But I'd rather go with the worst scenario in order to stop women from having to kill their babies. I think if a woman knew that if I kill this baby, it will go to hell. I'm sending that baby to hell. I think a lot of women will not have an abortion. But because the church, again, has been infiltrated by demons, and we are simply fitting our theology to fit the situation in the world, we give people comfort and says, oh, you know, they belong to Jesus, they all up in heaven. Maybe they're not. If Jesus' word is true, they're not. It's going to be an awful experience for Christians when they come up to heaven and they find out the child they aborted is not here. He's burning in hell. If you have had abortions, God will forgive you. But let me point something out to you now that is logical. And we need to be real people. We need not to put things out of the side. If I think I don't like a person, and I decide this, I'm going to kill that person. I get a gun or knife or whatever, stone, whatever it takes, I kill the person. And afterwards, I feel so bad, I said, God, I'm so sorry. Would you forgive me for killing that person? God says, yes, I forgive you. But that person is dead. That person has not become alive just because God has forgiven you. People get divorced. I'm not talking about pre-plan now when you do it, but let's say that people get divorced and later on they get saved and they ask God for forgiveness. You will be forgiven. But the marriage is gone. If you drive your car and you get drunk, or you get over, you seem to have taken drugs and you're impaired, and you kill somebody, or you, let's say you hurt somebody, you can ask God for forgiveness. He says, I forgive you. But the person you killed is still dead. God will forgive you if you had an abortion as a young woman and you were not saved and you did it, you didn't think it through. God will forgive you. But that baby would not make it. Think about that. I can be forgiven. You can be forgiven. But the consequences are there, and they will not change. So, Jesus said, murder is not acceptable. Sometimes we can murder people with words, but at least if you ask for forgiveness, they're still alive. But you kill somebody, it's permanent. We have a man in this ministry, he's a cyber member. His name is Mike from Indiana. Mike was going to drive to work one day and he's doing 50 miles an hour, two-way lane road. Another car was coming down and the man had some kind of heart attack or some kind of condition and he reared in, head-on collision. Mike has been in a wheelchair. He gets up once in a while. Broke his leg in about four or five places. Destroyed his stomach and everything else. Mike was a very hardworking person. Alive, testifying, witnessing, working hard. He's in a wheelchair. Now, if the man had a heart attack, the question is this. If he was not medically well, should he drive a car? Think about this. If you know that you have a condition that you might pass out, should you drive a car? The answer is no. You must say, well, this is America, I can do what I want to do. Yes, you can, but you can't. When you do what you want to do, somebody else will die. So now Mike, he was about 50, 55 years old when that happened. Unless God give him a creative miracle, that's how he's going to end his life here. As a cripple, he's always in pain. Because somebody had a medical condition. So, let's be very careful what we do. And that brings me now into anger. In Matthew 5:22. Jesus said, but I said to you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause, shall be in danger of the judgment, and whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of counsel, but whosoever shall say, you fool, shall be in danger of hell fire. What does Raca mean? It means worthless. Let me read it again. But I said to you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause, shall be in danger of the judgment. Whosoever shall say to his brother, you are worthless, you are a piece of junk, you are no good, you have no value, shall be in danger of the council. Those are angels. But who's going to say, you fool, you idiot, shall be in danger of hellfire. Look at that verse. You read it before, and you something says, okay, whatever. But this is something we need to really take heed to. Notice this. When do you get angry? Well, there's several different reasons. Let's say, for example, you miss the bus, or you were to take an air, fly someplace, and accident on the road, and you're stuck there for half an hour, and you get late, and you can't fly. You are angry. Okay, that's one type of anger. Now, there's not a whole lot we can do. You can be angry, or you can simply say, well, praise the Lord, God's in control, so I guess I catch another flight. Your blood pressure is doing much better if you have that attitude. But when we get angry, other times, I want you to do something. And you said, no, I'm asking Satyrus, I want you to do something for me. Satyrus said, no, I don't want to do that. Now, I get angry with him. And what I'm hoping to be, by simply saying, oh, just Satyrus, what's wrong with you, blah, 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 blah. I'm hoping to overpower him and to force him to do what I want. You know, when we get angry, it's taking a club, you know, and we just, boom, and that finished the conversation. And this is why there are so many divorces, because people get angry and they lose control. When you get angry, you have no more intelligence. The intelligence left the moment you get angry. And now you're just raw stupidity. So why did Jesus address that? When was the last time you heard a pastor preach on anger in the church? I don't think too many times. And you know, we have a temper as a human race. And this is what, when I do counseling with people in marriage, particularly marriage counseling, people can't control their anger. And they simply, they build up, and then they open their mouth, and here comes, F this, F that, blah, 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 hoo, ah. Children hear that. I said, wow, did you say that, Daddy? Yeah, I said that. When we are angry, it feels good to destroy things. We do stupid things. I had a demon of anger in me. When I was a child, I was a teenager. I built plastic models. I put in hours into them, painted them, and I placed them in my home. I lived with my parents at the time. And then, when I got really angry, they said, well, you can't go out, you cannot do this or that, and so on. I got so angry, I took one of the most beautiful plastic models I had, and I would go up in front of my mom and dad, and then, boom, crush it on the floor and say, there you go. And that's where I took out my anger. And that's what we do, many of us. We destroy so much when we get angry. How do you deal with anger? You got to die to yourself. You got to die to yourself. Now, Jesus said we ought to forgive people. We're going to be talking about that. So, here's what I do when anger comes. I'll take a deep breath. And then I said, control yourself. Many times I tell people this. How about, man, whatever is meaningful to you, go ahead. I don't care. And if I do get angry, I say something I shouldn't say, I ask God for forgiveness, and I ask the person to forgive me. My wife and I, we had an agreement early in our marriage. Never go to bed at night and having had a fight and not asking for forgiveness. Never go to bed angry. Satan will use that. So we always, before we went to bed, we says, okay, I'm sorry what we did today. We prayed, we made it up. And that was a very good thing. We were married for about 59 years. And then my wife was probably about 57 years we were together. Then the last 3 years she was in the care home. So you can't control your anger if you want to. You're crucified and say, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, not I live, but Christ lives. What does it mean when Jesus said, quote, somebody worthless? Rocker. You know, when you get angry, it feels good to dress down a person, call them an idiot. Simply say, you know, you should not even breathe. You're worthless. You are using up resources. Why don't you go and kill yourself? So let's do this. Let's simply do like Jesus told us here. Don't be angry. Don't call anyone worthless. And don't call anyone an idiot. Now, Joe Biden is acting like an idiot. He has dementia. But even before he had dementia, he had some stuff. So we can simply say he's an unwise person. But we don't want to go and call him a downright idiot. Let's go down to tithing now. Verse 23. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, and that remembers that your brother has aught against you, leave there your gift before the altar and go your way. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. What does that mean? Jesus said, when you bring your tithe or you bring an offering, he says, that's fine. But Jesus says this, I don't want it as long as you are angry. But God, I'm going to give you $10,000. Jesus said, I don't want your $10,000. I want you to repent. I want you to ask for forgiveness. Because if you are angry with a brother or a sister, with your wife or your whoever it is, another human being, he says, I don't want you in my presence. Jesus does not want angry people. He says, don't come and bring your tithes and offerings to the church. I'm not going to accept it. I don't want you. Repent. Now, few pastors would preach on that because we are hurt in the offering plate. People go, well, I don't know, I'm not going to give any more money to church because I got torn up. You know, people get offended. And when people get offended, they get angry. And when they get angry, they walk off. Let's look upon, I wanted to turn to, this is a scripture here, I do not have any outline, but I want to use it. It's in Matthew 18, 23. So turn to Matthew 18, and we're going to look in verse number 23. Therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king which would take account of his servants. And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him which owed him 10,000 talents. Let's say about $500,000. But for so much that he had not to pay, his Lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife and children all that he had, and payment to be made. The servant therefore fell down and worshipped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion and loosed him and forgave him the debt. But the same servant went out and found one of his fellow servants, which owed him 100 pence, 10 bucks. And he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, pay me what you owe. And his fellow servant fell down at his feet and besought him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. And he would not, but went and cast him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what was done, they were very sorry, and came and told unto the Lord all that was done. Then the Lord, after they called him, and said to him, O you wicked servant, I forgive you all that debt because you desired me. Should you not also have compassion on your fellow servant, even as I had pity on you? And the Lord was wroth and delivered to the tormentors till he should pay all that was due unto him. So likewise shall my heavenly Father do also to you, if you from your hearts forgive not every one his brother that trespasses. God has tormentors. These are angels. They're not bad. They just do their job. Hell is not run by the devil. It's not run by demons. It's run by God's holy angels. They are the prison guards. They're running it. Now, Jesus said this, we have to forgive and we cannot be angry. In verse 35 now, so likewise shall my heavenly Father do also to you, if you from your hearts forgive not everyone his brother their trespasses. Let me try to put this in a real setting here now. We're not going to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. That's 1 Corinthians, the third chapter. I'm trying to work something out. There we go. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. I'm in 2 Corinthians, doesn't work. First Corinthians, third chapter, and we pick it up here in verse is 11. For the foundation can no man lay than that is laid with Jesus Christ. Now if any man build upon this foundation gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide which is built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet says by fire. Now, where is that taking place? That's taking place in heaven. Now we go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And let's find out what happened here. That's 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And we read this in verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every one may receive the things done in his body according to what is done, whether it be good or bad. So far, so good. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are made manifest to God, and the test also made manifest in your consciences. Terror. Remember when we talked about the tormentors in Matthew chapter 5? Where Jesus said, you shall no way get out of there. Are you going to be turned over to the tormentors, and you will stay there until you have paid everything you owe, and then you get out. Now, this might not be the nicest message to give on a resurrection Sunday morning, but here's the deal. When you die, your body goes in the grave. I'm talking to Christians now. Your soul and spirit goes to heaven. And you have a soul body where you have a torso, you got legs and arms and brain and eyes and ears and so on. That's you. So you're just going to walk fine in the spirit world. You just dropped your car. So you get up to heaven. And they welcome you. And then they would say, you have a court date. What? Court date in heaven? Yes. Such and such a time, you are going to go to court. And he says, what for? Well, Jesus is going to examine your life, whether you've done good or bad. And you're going to say, well, I'm saved. Yes, you're saved. That's not a problem. You're not going to go to hell. You're saved. But you're going to be judged according to what you've done. Let me read again verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to done, whether it be good or bad. Now, you're starting to sweat. Oh, no. I never heard that in church. And the angels are going to say to you, there's a lot of stuff you didn't hear in church that you should have heard. But praise God you got saved. But you got a court date. So on your court date, you walk in to that courtroom. Here's Jesus. And he's looking down, and he's about to tell the angels in charge, roll his life. And on a big projector, and not on a big screen, it's projected your life. And you start out at the time of conception for you. Then you notice something, that everything that you did before you got saved is wiped out, blank. And you says, what happened? Well, Jesus paid for that. Now, it comes up to the point when you got saved. Suddenly now there's pictures. And now Jesus is watching it, you're watching it. And then suddenly you see something blank. And you ask an angel, what's that? That's when you repented and asked God to forgive you. And we took the blood and applied it, and you are forgiven for that. That's done. And then you said, I hope I did a lot of times. So now you're going to have intervals, and Jesus is going to say, you didn't repent of that. You didn't repent of that. And you did not repent of that. You go, oh no. And Jesus says, okay, here's how I'm going to sentence you. I paid for your sins. You are here. You are saved. But you are held accountable for things you did after your salvation. But I gave you an eraser. Because anything you ask for forgiveness for, the blood wipes it out. But sins, particularly anger and other things, resentments, that you didn't apply the blood to, you're going to pay for. And when Jesus is done, he's going to say this, okay. He will have a little computer thing. He will simply say this, goes into the place where they have the tormentors, so they can just pick you up. And you simply walked into the place of torment. And now, there's no excuse. Remember what Jesus said, you will not be let out until you paid the least to the last farthing or the last penny. Mm-hmm. So after a while, you get out. Oh, man, was that painful. Oh, was that painful. And you can't be angry now, but you're going to stay preaching down on earth. What were you thinking of? Why didn't you tell me this stuff? I would have repented what I'm telling you today. After that, you will join the rest of the saints, and you will have your position. Remember this. The maturity that you have the day you die is the maturity you will have for the rest of eternity. We will get more knowledge. We will learn a whole lot of things. But your maturity level is done here and now. If you know that, work on it. Control your anger. Be kind. Look what Jesus said and do it. On this earth, we have two types of people. People that simply, growing up as children, they says, well, I'm going to go to college. I'm going to take this. I'm going to go to a trade school, whatever it is. I'm going to learn something because I don't want to have minimum wage. You can't live on minimum wage. You can, but you know you don't eat a lot. And so those people that put in time in high school, college, or trade school, whatever it is, get their degrees, and now they can get a job that pays well, you know, so they can live comfortable. And then you have the yo-yos that simply play games, you know, they just take drugs and stuff in high school, you know, just play around. And if you live in California, it doesn't matter how bad you are, they graduate you anyway. You can't read when you get a high school diploma, but that's okay. You graduated. And now you try to get a job. And you find out, well, you can work at McDonald's, you can work at this burger grill here, whatever, or you can be cleaning over here, minimum wage. And after you've been out for about 4 or 5 years, you say, man, what were I thinking when I was in school? I mean, you know, look at my friends here. You know, they got nice jobs. I don't. And you realize, I didn't educate myself. I did everything except, you know, apply myself. Listen closely now. When you get to heaven, you're going to go through the judgment seat of Christ. I know I'm going to go there, and I'm doing my best. I said, God, remind me, I'd like to settle it here. I don't want to settle it up. I settle it here. I want to forgive here and whatever it is. And then you would say this, now, maturity-wise, what did I do on earth? Well, I did a lot of different things. You know, there were sports game, there were basketball, ladies, you know, you had your thing and so on. And you put in very little into your education for eternity. And you're going to come up like a high school dropout. And Jesus is going to say, I love you. Welcome to heaven. I'm glad you're here. But you're going to be judged. And heaven is not socialism. We're not woke up here. You will get what you earned. Let me repeat that. In California, it's socialism. If you don't work, somebody else will work and give you the money. But in heaven, it is not socialism. It's capitalism. It's performance. You're saved by grace. You can't work on that. You will make it to heaven. But are you going to go live up there first class, second class, third class? Have you ever thought about this? Now, let's say you've been in heaven for 10,000 years. And he says, wow, that's a long time. Are things going to change? No. You still have the same job. You've been there for 100,000 years. And you say, there's no change. I was on earth for 60 years, 70 or 80 years. And I was stupid. I goofed off. I didn't do anything to earn something in heaven. Do you see what I'm driving at today? Jesus simply said this. Forgive. Release. Don't murder. Keep my commandments. At the same time, he said, lay up treasures for yourself in heaven. For rust and moth and thieves cannot take it away from you. But don't put your treasures on earth. I realize now, I'm in my last period of life, 40, first period, 80, second one, I'm in my third one. Things that were important to me earlier, I realize now, if I have this curtain, if I have that curtain, you know, it doesn't make a difference. I'm beginning to see more and more eternal values. And this is where I want to take you today. So, let me have you turn, this is a scripture you don't have in the outline, but let me have you turn to the Gospel of John chapter 7. John 7, I think I beat this horse enough. If you don't understand it, there's not a whole lot I can do for you. I see you in heaven. outside the courthouse. Here comes my members. Well, hello, Satiris. Hello, Steve. Well, there's Carol. How are you doing, Carol? We haven't been into the courthouse. We got our appointments. Well, I try to prepare you folks. I think some of you are going to do well. And you says, I hope so. Dear God, I hope so. Yeah, I'll meet you there. And you would simply say, you know, sometimes I thought, Pastor, you were a little bit on the crazy side. You were too, you took things too literal, you know. We took it more, not serious. But I guess now it's a different song they sing up here. Yeah, it's a different song they sing up here. This is capitalism. This is not socialism. Mm-hmm. And now you're going to go into the courthouse. I see you, baby. I hope that you have a good time in there. You know what? All I can do is to prepare you here. And it's up to you. When I stand outside the courthouse and greet you when you were going in, don't blame me. I try to give my best. That's why I don't have too many members. You know, people don't like what I'm doing because they like an easy church. In the Gospel of John, chapter 7, verse number 37, we read this. In the last day, that great day of the feast, this is the Passover, but this is not the last Passover. It was an early one. Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believes on me, and the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. Many of the people, therefore, when they heard his saying, said of a truth, this is the prophet. But this spake he of the Holy Spirit. And let me ask you this. Are you baptized in the Holy Spirit? Have you yielded yourself not only to be saved, but you're baptized in the Holy Spirit? Are you hungry after the gifts of the Holy Spirit? Or are you simply a turkey walking on the ground and saying, I like it here. I got water. I got food here. It's an effort to get up. Or are you an eagle that says, I don't want to be just here. I want to soar. I want to see everything God has to experience for me. Because when you get up in heaven, yours is going to be judged about the Holy Spirit and the baptism of the Spirit. Because Jesus is going to ask you, I had a baptism of the Spirit for you, but you didn't like it. You didn't want to roll on the floor. You didn't want to speak in tongues. So you didn't want to have my gifts. That's going to be deducted from your position in heaven. I'm going to finish with this, Book of Acts, chapter 1. Book of Acts, chapter 1. Verse 4. And be assembled, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which he says he, you have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but you should be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Jesus said, you're not going to leave Jerusalem. You're not going to go into your ministry until you have been baptized in the Holy Spirit. Have you been baptized in the Holy Spirit? If you have been baptized in the Holy Spirit, are you working, are you walking in the gifts? Are the gifts being manifested in your life? Or you simply say, well, it's not really for me, you know, I'm not Pentecostal, I'm more of a Baptist type of people and so on. Well, he's going to ask you that when you get up to the judgment seat. And you're not going to be able to say, well, that's what I always done. I always done this and that. And he said, that's not good enough. Your job is to repent. Your job is to change. That's what Christianity is all about. Repentance and change on a daily schedule. That's as far as we can take here today on this subject. So what I want you to take away is simply this. We talk about anger, forgiveness. We talk about maturity. Why don't you, and I say this to you just about every Sunday, instead of goofing around this afternoon, why don't you take an hour or two by yourself? Because there's always a lot of chattering around you. Maybe go out in the park someplace, go someplace or sit in the car, and then say, God, where am I? Am I where you want me to be spiritually? Judge yourself. And the Holy Spirit shows you there needs to be some forgiveness. You need to read the Bible more. You need to be open to operating the gifts. You need to major more in spiritual things and not 100% in the physical. Then change. Because remember this. Here we can change. If you kill somebody, you can be forgiven, but that person cannot come back. But we can change. I don't care if you're 10 years old, if you're 30 years old or 90 years old, we can change. And says, God, I don't know how much time I got left on earth, but I want to use my last classes on earth to get some stuff in. I don't want to enter heaven and just polish the golden streets. I want more than a rag. I want to rule and reign with Christ. You can. But you got to make up your decision. You got to make that decision here, now. And if you make that decision, when I see you in heaven, I will remind you of Easter Sunday that I talked to you about this. And when you come up, some of you are going to grin from ear to ear and say, you know, I got mad when I heard your sermon, but I started to change. And I'm so glad I can go in to the courthouse and I can go in without having fear that I'm going to be beat up. Or I'll meet you there. You says, well, I heard you on that Sunday morning. I didn't like it. You know, so I just turned you off. Here I am now. I'm going to say, well, I'm sorry. I'm not going to hold your hand. I'm not going to walk in with you. You're on your own. There you go. If you watch me now and you are not saved, and you simply say this, how do I get in on this? How can I get saved? Well, here's how you got saved. You acknowledge you're a sinner. Acknowledge that you have sinned. Say, Father God, I believe that you sent your Son down to earth to die and pay for my sins. I believe that Jesus died on the cross, rose on the third day, and he paid for my sins. And I want to be saved. Jesus, come on in. Come on in, Jesus, and save me. And Jesus will. When we finish here, your screen will change. Three crosses will come up. You would hear the voice of Pastor Charles, and he would say, my friend. And then he would take 10 minutes with you and help you to understand what it means to be saved, pray with you, and you can be saved today and start your learning in the kingdom of heaven. If you do that today, would you call us, write us, and simply say, I got saved today. You know, I got blessed this Saturday, and Brother Satir got blessed, and Carol got blessed. This little lady, I don't know if it was a little or not, I called her a little lady, but she's the older side. I'm not an older side, so, but you know. Anyway, her name is Celeste, and she sent each one of us a card, a very nice card. And she watches us on a webcast, and she told Satiris how great he is. She told Carol how much he loved her. And she told me, you know, I'm not too bad either. And, you know, it's nice to hear from you guys. Right now, I'm looking out in a black tube, you know. I don't know who was out there. But another thing you can do is this, just write a note and say, hey, we heard you. We watch you. I just told Steve today he hasn't been around long enough that he got some fan mail. So if you like Steve, you know, he was a little bit on the teary side today. We need to get a card. So write him a card and tell him what you love him. And he would like that too. So anyway, take this afternoon. Take an inventory. And then say, God, change me. He will. Steve, come on, finish.
Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you and praise you for this beautiful Sunday, Resurrection Sunday. Father God, we thank you for this message. And Father God, I pray that you press this message deep into our souls and our spirits. Father God, help us to take inventory of our lives today, I pray. Help us to change, Father God, and help us to deal with everything while we're in the physical world down here, before we get to the other side and before we get into heaven, Father God. Help us to control our anger, turn away from our sins, and repent, Father God. And I thank you and I praise you, Father God. I just pray that you be with your people today as we go and spend the rest of this Sunday. Protect us, Father God, and keep us strong and healthy, I pray. In Jesus' precious name we pray, all God's people said, amen and amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the 13th part in the series, The Gospel of Matthew, and was entitled, The Attitude of Your Heart. Jesus wanted to set forth the doctrine of His future church, but the Jews were only interested in their self-serving policies because the God-man's words conflicted with their desires. Murder was common, and Jesus emphatically stated that homicide was unacceptable regardless of the circumstances and was never an option in the kingdom of God. It struck a raw nerve when the God-man talked about anger. The Son of God warned that aside from righteous anger directed at sin, this powerful emotion is not tolerated in the spirit world. Unforgiveness does not exist in heaven, and those who claim to be followers of Jesus need to seek reconciliation before they come to present an offering to the Lord. Jesus astonished the people with His words, but the God-man was simply setting the standard by which they should live. Your attitude is like the aroma of your heart. Do you smell good? How well do you measure up to the words of Jesus? This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1907. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store.
The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.